I think most of the participants have got entry. Nakramit.
Yes, sir.
So welcome to this last day of this training program on ECE that was of 7-day duration. So we came to the last day session, and this session is for the queries and question answer session from the participants. So on this day, I heartily welcome our speaker, our teacher, Dr. Belankar sir, for this session. So sir, we have got 7 to 8 questions for this session, and after addressing these 7 to 8 questions, we will allow participant to ask any query regarding this electrocardiography in canine or canine cardiology or treatment aspect. Anything they want to ask, they can ask. So meanwhile, Dr. Amit, allow the participant after addressing these 8 questions by hand raising and one by one.
Yes, sir.
So now over to sir, Belankar sir.
So the first question what I have got is regarding the what books will be better for further reading, or is there any web or Google link for the same? Now the books which you can refer, they are thorough and good to understand the subject, is first by the Tilley, LP, Essentials of Canine and Feline Electrocardiography. You can consider this book as the Bible or Bhagavad Gita of electrocardiography. You should have this book in your library, at home library rather. Then second is Bolton by G.R. Bolton, B-O-L-T-O-N, Book of Canine Electrocardiography. This book is also good, making the subject easier and with smooth flowing language. So this is also another book which you should have in your home library for studying electrocardiography. Now the second question is, and regarding the website, you can just type the word canine heart and you will get abundant of website. There is no specific website as such for which you can go in for this. All majority of the websites, when you say the basics of electrocardiography, if you put this word in dog, I think you will get n number of websites. You can choose any one of your liking. Then what is the ECG based criteria to confirm DCM? Then the DCM, as we have seen, we know that it is the dilated cardiomyopathy. That means the heart is dilated. Majority times there is an issue of valves, then leading to dilatation. Or sometimes if it's a genetic issue, then first the heart dilates and then the problem with the valvular coaptation starts, and then the you can get the valve problems. So in these cases, there is an enlargement of the left atrium, then left ventricle. Then later on, it may be, if it is a left-sided failure, if it's a right-sided failure, you will also have the right atrial enlargement, right ventricular enlargement. Generally, left follows the right, and therefore you will have the both-sided heart, that is the right and left, both failures can occur together. And therefore you will be getting, depending upon the case which you are studying or it under your consider diagnosis, if it has a left atrial and left ventricular enlargement on the ECG rhythm strip, you will have, we know that the criteria for left atrial enlargement is the wide P waves and the wide and tall QRS complexes. So this will be the basic criteria for left atrial and left ventricular enlargement. Whatever is there, according to your reading in the ECG, that will be your diagnosis. Whether there is a wide P waves, you say there will be left atrial enlargement, and then in still further advanced cases, the left ventricle also enlarged. So there will be left atrial enlargement with left ventricular enlargement. And then later on, if you are studying a case with having the right-sided failure also, then you may get the criteria that fulfill the tall P waves and the we'll also find that some of the criteria like S1, S2, S3 pattern, right axis deviation, etc., what we studied, those will be apparent on the ECG. So there is no fixed criteria on the, as the question has been asked, the ECG-based criteria. So these are the ECG-based criteria, because whatever is going to be in that patient is going to be reflected in the ECG. And by reading that, you have to diagnose accordingly. And then this is the first criteria, what we do with the ECG. And remember, ECG is not a panacea. It is not complete, and therefore complete diagnostic. It gives you a clue regarding the this particular, these are the likelihood changes. These are seen in the ECG. So accordingly now, the second diagnostic tool is generally the, we take the, that is the X-ray, the radiography. And in radiography also, if you get the cardiac silhouette, now in this X-ray, we generally calculate the VHS, that is the vertebral heart size. And therefore, if VHS is the normal standard VHS value is 9.7 plus minus 0.5 in case of the dog. That value has been given by Buchanan and Bushler. And this value, and if it is more than this, that is the more than 10.3, then we say there is a cardiac enlargement. Or second criteria generally, which is generally not considered, is a cardiac indexing. If the cardiac shadow is occupying more than 66% space in the thoracic cavity, this is taken by DV view, whereas the VHS we take in the lateral view. So if it is occupying more than 66%, then generally we consider that there is a cardiac enlargement. And the cardiac indexing is done as per the method prescribed by described by Hamlin, 1968. Now, so depending upon the anatomical changes, this is done. And electrocardiographically, you will also get, you may get atrial fibrillation also. You may get the ventricular VPCs or ventricular tachycardia. So it all depends upon the severity of the case you are getting on the table. Then third question is dietary modification for the dogs with the heart disease. Now, whenever there is a heart disease, naturally, that means the we have a problems with the generally DCM. So in DCM cases, we prescribe generally a salt-free diet. Or even if there is a blood pressure problem, the restriction is on the diet, because salt causes retention of the fluids and which adds to the volume. And therefore, the heart has to pump extra for dealing with that particular volume. And therefore, there is a rise in the blood pressure because of the salt retention. So therefore, restricting the salt in the diet, we don't stop it totally, but we restrict the salt intake. Then cardiac diet is generally prescribed. Now the ready-made grain-free cardiac diets are available. They should generally be recommended. Or at homes, if you are going to prepare, it should have legumes like lentils, peas, then potatoes, sweet potatoes, non-traditional proteins other than your chicken and beef. So these should not be you can prepare either the home cooked diet or the cardiac diets which are ready-made available. They can be very well offered to the patients. Then you have to add carnitine to the diet, because carnitine is an amino acid that takes long chain fatty acids into the cardiac cell, which is actually a fuel for the cardiac cell for the metabolism. And therefore, carnitine and taurine, they should be added to the diet. So these are generally the restrictions. And plus, you can add the fish oil, because generally, the patients with heart diseases, they suffer from cachexia. And therefore, the addition of the few fish oil to the diet helps in improving the condition of the patient, particularly from the cachexia. Then which calcium channel should be best for supraventricular tachycardia? Now, supraventricular tachycardia, as it is supraventricular, so digitalis is the best drug of choice, first drug of choice to improve. And if at all you want, there is some problem while utilizing your digitalis drug, then the calcium channel, or that is the drug is the diltiazem we can use, and which is a slow calcium channel blocker. That will be the first choice. Then process of digitalization in dog. In the process of digitalization of the dog, the dose in case of digitalization, the digitalis glycosides, whatever you are using, digoxin or digitoxin, they have the low level or narrow margin of therapeutic safety. And therefore, we have to monitor the patient carefully whenever we are actually starting the therapeutic use. And the optimum plasma concentration in case of the dog is between 1 to 2 nanogram per ml. And average effect, the adverse effect of the drug will commence after the concentration goes 3.5 nanogram per ml. Now by dosing, when you are calculating the dose should be calculated on lean body weight basis. And also the dose is based upon the type of preparation you are using. If it's an elixir, that is the liquid preparation of lanoxin, then dose should be 10% less than the calculated dose because of the easy availability, the fast easy availability and the rapid absorption. Now, the dosing for rapid digitalization is 0.0055 to 0.011 milligram per kg body weight. And this is given in 1 hour to the effect. And for maintenance, we use the dogs which are less than 20 kg body weight, 0.01 milligram per kg body weight, BID, and more than 20, the on body weight, the body weight based on the this body surface area basis, it is 0.22 milligram per square meter of the body. Now the dose adjustment regarding the digitalis, it is according to the status of the disease process. Then the concomitant drug therapy, because there are some drugs which increase the levels of the digoxin, like amiodarone, diazepam, diltiazem, ketoconazole, erythromycin, or quinidine. These drugs will increase the doses of ingested digoxin, or some they decrease the levels, like oral antacids, metoclopramide, phenobarbital, chloramphenicol, then sulfasalazine. They will decrease the level of digoxin, and therefore we have to take into consideration whatever concomitant drug therapy we are giving, because they either alter the volume of distribution or biotransformation or even influence the excretion of the drug, and therefore we have to take into that consideration for maintenance of the proper therapeutic level. Similarly, you have to also take into consideration the pulmonary disease or electrolyte levels and the creatinine clearance. Now, the sixth question is the lignocaine, ventricular tachycardia. In ventricular tachycardia, amiodarone is the best or other drug we can use. Now, in ventricular tachycardia, lidocaine is the first drug of choice, and it is to be given IV and then repeated. Again, you can give it up to 8 milligram per kg body weight total, and then thereafter you can give, if the tachycardia doesn't abate, then it can be continued as continuous rate infusion. But and for oral maintenance, later on you can use maxiletine, that is an oral analog of the lidocaine. Then the amiodarone you can use, sotalol you can use. So the other drugs are there. Now the question seven is diagnosis of which conditions the chest leads are compulsory to perform. Chest leads are generally in veterinary practice, as we have discussed, they are not very well developed as in human beings. And therefore, there are two leads we can use. One is a lead V10. V10 is number one, easy to record. And secondly, it is always negative in all the dogs. And if it is except Chihuahua and except this, and if it is positive, then it is an indication of right ventricular enlargement. This V leads, most of them give information regarding the right ventricular enlargement. Then other lead we are going to use is V4, that is V6, CV6 LU. If it shows a Q wave greater than 0.7 millivolt, then it is a right ventricular enlargement. So in V4 lead, if the S wave is greater than 0.7 millivolt, it gives the indication of right ventricular enlargement. So these are the two leads generally we require if we suspect the right ventricular enlargement. Then last question is, in case of congestive heart failure, what is the line of treatment? In congestive heart failure, the basic changes that occur in the body are, the heart is unable to beat with the body's requirement due to the enlargement. So the efficiency of the pumping of the heart is affected because it is dilated. And therefore, because of the inefficient pumping, and there is a pulsation all over the body, the fluid retention, because of the inadequate contractility of the myocardium, and the congestive heart failure develops gradually. And therefore, our aim of therapy is to improve the myocardial contractility. Number two, we have to now reduce the volume overload. And therefore, we are going to improve the myocardial contractility by addition of positive inotropic agent or the drugs which improve the myocardial contractility. Number two is reduce the volume overload. When you reduce the volume overload by applying the extra pump in the form of asking kidney to excrete more urine, and therefore we'll be adding diuretics to the therapy. Then third is reduce the pressure overload. Because of the excess blood volume, heart has to pump extra the same amount of blood. And therefore, to ease the functioning of the heart, number one, we are trying to reduce the blood volume by using the diuresis. And secondly, we help to dilate the blood vessels a little. And therefore, we use the drugs like enapril, that is the S inhibitors. Then addition of multivitamins, then the heart cardiac tonic drugs, then the amino acids like carnitine, taurine, then CoQ10, then dietary restriction of salt, and to reduce the cardiac cachexia, addition of the fish oil to the diet. Now, for improving the myocardial contractility, we can use the drugs like digoxin. Then there is another drug which is now currently being used, that is the pimobendan. Then to reduce the volume overload, you can use the furosemide or combination of furosemide and spironolactone. Spironolactone is aldosterone antagonist, and therefore it also helps in preventing the pathological remodeling. Then reduce the pressure overload. As I told you, we can use the drugs like enalapril or ramipril, captopril, etc. So this is the basic line of treatment for dilated cardiomyopathy. Mukesh?
Sir, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, more than 100 participants had joined today.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
This ECG. and canine cardiology. So I will request Dr. Amit to please allow participant to ask any query.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Velankar, sir. So now this is open session. Now any participant, if they want to ask any question, please raise your hand so that I can make you co-host, and then you can unmute yourself and you can put your question in front of sir. So now this is open session. Any participant, if they want to ask any question, please raise your hand so that I can unmute you.
Dr. Vinod Vyas has raised hand.
So I made Dr. Vinod Vyas as a co-host. Now he can unmute himself. Over to Dr. Vinod.
Sir, good evening.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, Vinodji.
Yes, sir. Management of hypertension in case of dogs. Management of hypertension. Systemic hypertension
is generally we are using the for that particularly the antihypertensives. But how you are establishing the hypertension?
Systemic hypertension.
Systemic hypertension, that is what I'm asking, under which condition? Because in that case, in the case
chronic renal cases.
Then in that case, you can use the drugs like diazepam, or you can use the drugs like
enalapril, sir.
At enalapril, no. You are additionally adding, and plus you can use the even atenolol. You can use sympatholytic drugs for management of the antihypertensives, taking into consideration the heart rate.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Doctor,
thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Doctor Sona Bai is there.
Yeah.
So
please,
I'll make him co-host. Yes, sir. Doctor Sona Bai can unmute, and then. Dr. Sona Bai, yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my question is, yesterday you said about the pre-exciting condition in pups, sir. I mean, dog, sir. Sir, is it congenital or after birth also it will be seen in pups and adult dogs, sir?
It has been practically rare in dogs.
Yes, sir.
It is rare in dogs. This
condition
has been reported by that author I told you in 1961.
Okay, sir.
Thereafter, there has been no reports of this pre-excitation.
Okay, sir.
And that in human beings, yes, it is genetic.
In human beings, sir, is it congenital, sir?
It is reported as genetic condition. Yes.
Sir.
And then you have to actually undergo the ablation and removal of the and the discontinuing the tracks.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Sir, when we go through with the ECG test and all, sir, what are all the symptoms we can see, sir? Conditions like PR interval will be more longer or is it shorter, sir?
Where? Pre-excitation?
Yes, sir.
In pre-excitation, ventricles are activated prior to the impulse before reaches the trauma conduction system. It reaches to the ventricles faster.
Okay, sir.
You find that the PR interval will be very short.
Okay, sir.
It is less than 0.06 seconds.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Next, Dr. Amit is there. He has raised his hand, so I will unmute him. Dr. Amit, I made him co-host. Now he can unmute himself. Dr. Amit?
Hello. Sir, brain injury and skeletal disease is also detected by ECG?
Which one?
Brain injury.
I didn't follow your question.
Hello?
Sorry.
Sir, brain injury can be detected by ECG?
Brain injury. I think that is by EEG, electroencephalo. Sir, he is asking about brain injury.
I could not hear you.
Sir, he is asking that can brain injury can be diagnosed or confirmed by the electrocardiography or not?
No. It is by EEG,
encephalogram. Encephalogram.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, we have Dr. Utpal Das. He has raised his hand. I made Dr. Utpal as a co-host. Now he can unmute himself. Dr. Utpal, sir, you can unmute yourself. I have made you co-host. Please unmute. Hello. Sir, I made Dr. Utpal Das as a co-host, but I think he is unable to unmute himself. There is a mic button on the lower left side of your device. You can just click it so that the red cross will disappear. Okay, I think technical issue, or he is unable to unmute. Any other participant want to ask any question regarding ECG? Yeah, again, Dr. Vinod Vyas is there. Dr. Utpal Das, yes. Sir, Dr. Utpal Das, you are already co-host. Please unmute yourself. Sir, Dr. Utpal Das is, I think, unable to unmute himself.
No issue if anybody other is there, you can invite him. Otherwise, we will proceed for concluding.
Yes, sir, we have again Dr. Vinod Vyas is there. Dr. Hemant Kumar is there. But Dr. Hemant Kumar, I'll make you co-host. Yes, Dr. Hemant. Dr. Hemant, Dr. Harshit Saxena is there. Yes, Dr. Harshit Saxena.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening. Yeah, please.
Sir, I want to ask that we have seen several ECG traces in which the T waves are both positive and negative. Sir, why it have, and both are considered as normal. Sir, why it has happened that in some...
Please repeat your question. I think, sir, Melankar, sir, you are muted, sir. Sir, please unmute, sir.
Sir, he is asking that many times T wave is upright or sometime below the baseline, means maybe biphasic, and all three conditions are considered normal. Why it's happened? His question is why T wave may be normal, may be upright, may be below baseline, and may be biphasic, sir.
Now this is because of the individual, that is the species specific. In case of the dogs, there is no specific criteria that the T wave will be positive or it will be negative, but it should maintain, or it can be even biphasic, but it should maintain that polarity throughout the rhythm strip. It should not alter the polarity, and that happens. Either it can be positive throughout the rhythm strip, or it can be negative throughout the rhythm strip, or even it can be biphasic if it is having some metabolic disturbances like hypokalemia. So it can be even biphasic, but it should be same throughout the, what you say, the throughout the rhythm strip. And if it is altering, then there is some issue with the oxygenation of the myocardium. Or even if it changes its amplitude, even that, then that is also change particularly that is observed by the anesthetist during the anesthesia procedure. Why it is positive or why it is negative, it is the species characteristic.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, we have Dr. E. Tamilanian raised his hand. I'll make him co-host. Now he can unmute himself.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, blood clot in any major arteries can be diagnosed by ECG, sir?
No. For that, you have another modality, that is a Doppler.
Thank you, sir.
Only you can detect there is no pulse by your manual palpation.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
We have Dr. Nitin Vaishnav. He has raised his hand. So now he can unmute himself. Dr. Nitin Vaishnav. Dr. Nitin Vaishnav, please unmute.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, few days earlier, we have a case of left lung tumor in a dog. So his heart was dislocated to right side, towards the right side of the body. Right. And we observe their heart rate by putting the hand on the chest, and he have the tachycardia, increased heart rate. So what was the reason behind this? Behind the tachycardia?
See, number one is tachycardia means what was the heart rate?
Sir, we have no, we don't count actual, sir, actually complete heart rate, but by putting the hand, we observe the heart rate was very rapid, sir.
There are two, three criteria. When you say tachycardia, it has to be above 160. Number two, you are saying there is a pulmonary, it was a case of tumor, right?
Yes, sir.
Have you viewed the x-ray of the patient?
Yes, sir.
What was the, how much area was occupied by the, and was it a mediastinal lymph node tumor?
No, sir. It is, we think it is, it was the tumor of lung, left lungs, because the ribs are splitted and tumor comes to, from the rib between the intercostal space.
Because what happens, it is a space-occupying lesion, and therefore it is going to displace the heart. It is going to cause embarrassment of the cardiac movement, and therefore this rotation is possible because of the displacement by the tumor.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Next,
thank you, sir.
Dr. Mal Swam, Dr. Rathle is there, so I will just unmute. I'll make co-host, so now he can unmute himself. Dr. Mal Swam Longi Rathle.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello. Yes. Hello, sir. Good evening. To measure the blood pressure of animals, say dog, cats, and even for large animals, can we use the same digital sphygmomanometer like we use for humans? Or if not so, how do we measure the blood pressure?
There are two methods. We can use by your Doppler, using the instrument like DopVet, or VetDop, sorry. Doppler. And secondly, you can use the oscillometric method.
Okay.
In oscillometric method is more accurate rather fairly accurate.
Okay,
rather.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay, thank
and,
you.
And it is available with our Indian markets also, because for VetDop, I think you will have to import it.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So there is a Dr. Rajesh Kumar is there. He has raised his hand, so I will just make him co-host. Now he can unmute himself. Dr. Rajesh Kumar.
Hello.
Yeah, please, sir. Sir, you are audible, sir. Please, little bit louder.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Yeah, sir, I want to know without ECG and X-ray, how we can detect the heart cardiac problems?
You can without ECG and
X-ray also. We don't have facility right now here.
Yes. Now you can only have the
blood
the
test.
Yes. First is a history.
Okay.
That the patient has an exercise intolerance.
Yes.
And it has a weakness, lethargy, then not obeying the owner to regarding the regular movements, he is lethargic. If you take him for a walk for few steps, he sits down. So all these steps, but of course you have to rule out the other causes that cause exhaustion and weakness, that is anemia or any other problem. And then when you auscultate this patient, generally you have an increased area of auscultation. At least auscultation you will have to carry out.
Okay, we will do that.
Yeah. So on that, these criteria, increased area of auscultation, then the history of exercise intolerance, and there is no other problem, anemia, which can cause the exhaustion. Your CBC report, that is hemoglobin, should be normal in that case. Yeah. But for diagnosis of the... other things, the patient with pericardial effusion, you will have a increased shadow, isn't it?
Okay.
So in case, so therefore for diagnosis, then final gold standard test is the echocardiography.
Okay, sir. In blood test, what are the blood tests we can perform for cardiac problems, sir?
For cardiac problem, they say there are cardiac biomarkers, what you can use, the ANP, BNP, troponin, but these are all expensive tests. And secondly, their margins of normalcy are extremely high. And therefore, generally, they cannot be taken as 100%. Yes, they do increase in certain conditions. But these markers, they have to be collected at a specific time. Otherwise, their half-life is very short.
Okay.
And secondly, in case of the DOC, their normal values range. They are very, fast. And therefore, we cannot take them, yes, or it.
Sir, you are muted, sir. I think got auto-clicked from side.
Technically got muted.
Yes, sir.
Therefore, they cannot bypass ECG and X-ray for primary diagnosis of the heart disease, and coupled with your anamnesis.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we have Dr. Rajinder Bhardwaj. Dr. Rajinder Bhardwaj is there, so I will make him co-host. Now he can unmute himself.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, what are the ECG changes in, sir, aortic arches, sir? In dogs, na? Persistent aortic arch, sir.
No, these changes are not detected in the ECG.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. These are all echocardiographic studies.
Okay.
Yeah, only you can make out, detect by the heart sounds. Yes, particularly this PDA whenever it is there. So these changes can be heard by the auscultation, and there are no ECG changes in case of the aortic arch, as far as the ECG is concerned.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we have Dr. Jai Mohan. I will make Dr. Jai Mohan as a co-host. Now he can... Unmute and ask the question.
Good evening, sir. Thank you for the excellent presentation. I just want to ask you one doubt, sir. In canine heartworm, like a dyrophilaria.
Yeah.
Will there be any significant ECG changes, and how we can have some clue regarding carinic heartworm infection?
In early stages, there may not be changes.
Okay, sir.
Because it inhibits the right ventricle.
Okay.
So only the enlargement changes can be detected on ECG. But if their population is very small and there is no enlargement, if obstruction is less, then there will not be any electrocardiographic changes. But later on, if there is a dilatation, so in such cases, but generally when the population exceeds, generally the patient dies. So the cardiac enlargement changes can be only with regard to the right ventricle and the right atrium.
So will it be of any use in the diagnosis other than our blood smear examination like that?
You can take the help only.
Okay.
You can only detect the changes.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Sir, we have Dr. Harshit Saxena. So I will make him co-host. Now he can unmute himself and he can ask the question. Dr. Harshit.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
I want to ask that in an ECG trace, if we are having the trace of different leads like 1, 2, 3 AVR, AVL, AVF, and other precordial leads also. So that how can we judge that which lead we have to choose or which trace we have to choose to diagnose a particular problem like of arrhythmia or heart rate or?
No, you have to take the regular ECG. That is why we use that Bellas exaxial system. So 6 leads.
Yes, sir.
So those 3 leads, 1, 2, 3.
Yes, sir.
So we just attach those 4 leads there, and by selecting the button,
okay,
we are just capturing the 4 limbs of the animal, out of which only 3 are used. That is the right arm, left arm, and the left leg. Right leg is not used for recording purpose. It just goes as a reference. And then when you select the leads, lead 1, lead 2, lead 3, that time automatic that positioning of this is positive lead, this is negative lead, or this becomes the reference lead. So accordingly, the machine selects that. That is not your botheration.
No, sir. I am asking that the pattern which we see in different leads are like different. So, sir, for diagnosing a separate set of problem like for arrhythmia or something like that, so which lead we have to choose to?
You have to study the rhythm strip too. That will give you idea regarding. That is why we use lead 2 for this.
Okay,
because all the cardiac changes, it is closer, very close to the mean cardiac axis, that is the electrical flow of the heart, and therefore, and on that you can very easily study the P wave, you can study the QRS.
Okay, sir.
And looking at those, their positions and any changes, any alterations in their configuration, their presence, their appearance, their presence or absence simultaneously, looking differently. So all these are nothing but the criteria for arrhythmia. We have solved those 5 questions, na? Whether they look alike, whether they follow that synchronous sequence. So those criteria are judged on that, and looking at those criteria, we diagnose the condition. There is no condition-based ECG. The conditions are diagnosed on the appearance of the ECG.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, I think last time seeing Dr. Gaurav is there. So I just made him co-host. He can ask the question. And then the session is over to Dr. Mukesh, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I want to know, sir, is there any stage or something like that that certain percentage of, after that certain percentage of block that we can detect through ECG about heart blocks?
No, we can only detect the presence. We cannot detect how much percent is the block.
No, sir. Actually, I mean to say, is there any stage or this much percentage means at which stage we can detect? Means after this percentage of block, we can detect, or is there anything like that?
No, there is no categorization we can only say you can detect the block by its presence. That now in first degree heart block, we say ki there is a prolongation of PR interval. Prolongation means for now, if you consider the 0.06 to 0.13, then at if your PR interval has become gone to 0.16, it doesn't mean it is a 30% block. There is no such criteria as such. There is only a delay. It's a delay. By how much percent you cannot detect. Or in second degree heart block, the QRS complex is blocked. So if one is blocked or two is blocked, we don't say anything. But if it is more than alternate, that is 2:1 second degree heart block, 3:1 second degree heart block, 4:1, we say, yes, it is the advanced second degree heart block. That means this is severe. So we categorize it that way. You cannot get a percentage for that purpose.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, one more hand raise I am seeing here, but session is over to Dr. Mukesh, sir. Sir, Gautam Mukherjee. Dr. Gautam Mukherjee has raised the hand. After this, Mukesh, sir, can please unmute himself.
Yeah, I am unmuted. Yeah. And if one participant has left, then allow him to speak. And
yes, sir, only one is there. Dr. Gautam Mukherjee, only one.
So take this last one, okay?
Yeah, okay, sir. Dr. Gautam Mukherjee, sir, I have made you co-host. You can unmute yourself.
Yes,
Dr.
Sir.
Gautam Mukherjee.
Yeah. Sir, one question. In case of irregular heartbeat, how can you measure the heart rate?
Hello.
In case of irregular heartbeat, irregular rhythm, how can you measure the heart rate?
Heart rate you can actually measure by auscultation also, or you can take the
in ECG pulse. Through ECG paper.
Through ECG paper, you have to calculate the R waves.
Sometimes the R wave is small, sometimes the R wave will be bigger. Distance between the R wave is different. So how can you measure it?
These are two methods. What I told you. You have to see the number of R waves in 3 seconds.
Three-second method.
Criteria is the same. And if there is no R wave in between, you can say it's a long period of bradycardia, or there's a sinus block for that matter.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. So session over to Dr. Mukesh, sir.
Thank you, sir, for solving the queries of our participant. So in the last of this training program, we are very privileged to have among us Dr. Abdul Samad sir, former Dean Faculty and Director Instruction MAFSU Nagpur, and excellent academician and scientist from the field of veterinary medicine. I feel honored to invite Dr. Samad sir for concluding remark of the last day of this training program. Over to Dr. Samad sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mukesh. Congratulations to Dr. Velankar.
Thank you, sir.
As well as all the delegates for this wonderful course, which has been organized by the society. I think first time I'm seeing a society, you know, which is really striving to empower its members with, you know, new knowledge, new techniques. And this is something, you know, which is a very welcome step. And I hope that, you know, this will continue with some frequency. May not be a week's training course, but maybe a shorter one. There were a few things which I wanted to add, you know, when there were questions and answer session was going on. Dr. Velankar has rightly said that, you know, carnitine is, you know, one of the supplements which can be used, because carnitine will do the acylation of fatty acids and it will take across the mitochondria for energy purposes. But one thing, you know, you should understand that carnitine is available in the market in two different forms. One is L-carnitine and DL-carnitine.
L-carnitine.
Okay. L-carnitine and it has got a better bioavailability than D-L-carnitine. D-L-carnitine, you would say that it is around 50% of the L-carnitine. Now, as far as L-carnitine is concerned, this I'm saying, because that was one of my topics, which I had dealt, during my PhD program as a, I had submitted a assignment on it. Carnitine absorption is around 50 to 55% bioavailability. And therefore, you should be very, and the bioavailability of carnitine is in two phases. If you give a larger dose, then bioavailability goes down, because the absorption is passive. And this holds good even for a very large number of drugs. So this is something, which now the clinician should understand, that where a dose rate is given, going beyond the dose rate, substantially, is going to cause problems, because then you are not going to get right absorption, because then it has gone into passive mode. And that holds true even for calcium especially. And there are quite a few papers published which say that when you give more calcium, you get symptoms like rickets. Because with more of calcium, the absorption is not in active form, it is passive, and then net absorption is less. So these are this is one point which you should remember. Second point, which I wrote, maybe Dr. Velankar might have touched on it, and that is drug-drug interaction. This is another area where the vets need to focus. Probably this is not dealt in our pharmacology courses in detail, but this has become a very major area because we give more than one drug at a time, and then we should know how these two drugs are going to interact if given together, or even if it is going one after another. And the best example I would like to give here is because you are having a cardiology course, and Lasix or furosemide is one drug which is very commonly used. So furosemide, number one, furosemide has to be used very sparingly, and you have to be very careful because it has got a lot of side effects also. Number two, its drug interaction is known to be very severe with gentamicin, canamycin, neomycin, all those kind of drugs. So you should understand that whenever you are using aminoglycosides, then furosemide has to be used sparingly. And then another thing is, I think Dr. Velankar has pointed out, which I would like to reemphasize, that when you are using diuretic, try to rotate. Instead of using same diuretic for a prolonged period of time, if you can keep on rotating it, you'll get better results. Similar issue is with digoxin. Digoxin, if you give more, then the absorption is less. Whereas if you give, and this problem become more acute for us because the drugs that are available is for human. And the human tablets, if you give, if you want like to adjust the dose by breaking, your tablet to 10 kg dog, then it becomes very difficult. And then overdosing, you either go overdosing or you go, less dosing. So therefore, for such preparations, I usually prefer if it is available in liquid form, because then in liquid form you can dilute, and you will be able to give it to the dog in the correct dosage form. There was one more question which was on intracranial pressure, I was just referring to my grand rounds and minor rounds in OVC when I was doing PhD, and at that time this issue was also raised, and there are now papers also published which say that if there is raised intracranial pressure, then you do have ECG changes, like changes in the T wave and QT interval, notched in the T wave. So those kind of, but the other signs of raised intracranial pressure is so obvious that I don't think somebody would go to do ECG to diagnose intracranial pressure. But this could be one of the findings when you are doing this, when you are taking ECG. So you should also keep in mind that raised intracranial pressure might also happen, and especially raised intracranial pressure because of space occupying lesion. Then I have few suggestions if you guys don't mind. I think what for a continuous education program, there are two things which the society should do along with. One thing is having clinical round if it is possible, because right now what we have had was a basic run through of a course, but if we could have clinical rounds. Like minor round or grand round every week where a case is presented, then it becomes more comprehensive. People would be understand more. For example, in Canada, they have a platform where all the colleges are joined together, and we used to have what was called as a grand clinical round or minor clinical round, where good cases which had undergone diagnostic procedures were presented. So that kind of activity, if society can start, and I think we should also involve in that private practitioners, because I do feel private practitioners, there is expertise available there, there is clinical resources. So if they are also encouraged to present cases and let the students also join, so that will make a good difference. The second suggestion, if I may have, I tried this when I was dean, but I could not succeed because everybody thought that why should I share my teaching material with all others. Can the society also looking at a repository of clinical cases, say the repository of good radiological photographs with illustration, repository of Dr. Velankar has got excellent stock of the ECGs, so ECGs with some running commentary. If those kind of repositories, if it is there on society's website, then the process becomes continuous. Whenever I am in difficulty, I can always go and refer to, and the rate of learning is always high. When I need that information, rather than listening to information when I do not need it. If I have a case and if I have something, I have done an ECG. And then I want to find out, what exactly is this? So can I go back and refer to, the inventory if it is available, repository if it is available? That will be something good, which will come out. Of course, this will take a long time, but can we make a beginning? You need to focus on it. With these few words, another thing I was to, suggest to Dr. Velankar why not write he writes a book on ECG for us, because then going to feline cardiology or of foreign authors, the way they would explain, and the basic threshold of the information which they suppose with their students or with their vets. Probably might not be true, with our students or with our because we are all mixed practitioner kind, and when we are teaching in the college, we don't teach much about dog, we teach more on cattle. Yeah. But when you go out, you have more opportunities to practice advanced medicine in pet animals. So that becomes an issue, and for that reason, I think if Dr. Velankar can make an attempt to write a manual, practical manual where people can refer it to, or some kind of book where there is not a lot of theoretical jargon, but how to take this is ECG, how to do interpretation, the spread out of this course, I think will make a baseline for him to start writing a book. And if that is done, I think the society should give him enough support, and we are also there if he needs any editing assistance or any other kind of assistance, we would be very happy to do that. With these few words, I congratulate all the participants. I think they have and the kind of active participation I have seen appears to me that they have really taken this course seriously, and they have been benefited by it. With these few words, I hand over the the platform to Dr. Mukesh. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Your suggestions and advice will be discussed with the executive committee, and sir, definitely we will plan as per your suggestions some clinical conferences or some other things, sir, whatever you have suggested. And Dr. Ashok sir is there with us, general secretary, our general secretary of this society. So we are pleased to have among us Dr. Ashok sir, a principal scientist, CIRG, ICR, and general secretary of BIPM. Dr. Ashok sir is an excellent researcher from the field of animal health, that is veterinary medicine, and has written so many books on ethno-veterinary medicine and other aspect of the veterinary medicine, and has been granted for more than 4 to 5 patent. I feel honored to invite Ashok sir for the addressing this validity session of 7-day ECG course. Dr. Ashok sir.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mukesh. So now we come to the end of a very long 7 days e-course on the basic of ECG. The title looks the basics of electrocardiography, but it appears to me that it is in-depth knowledge of electrocardiography after completion of 7 days of e-course. So again, this is the privilege of the General Secretary of Veterinary Internal and Preventive Medicine Society to present the vote of thanks on the completion of this very important, very excellent e-course on ECG. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude and sincere thanks to the excellent orator, teacher, academician, scientist, and the speaker of this complete e-course, Dr. Valankar sir. Dr. Valankar is an outstanding teacher. He has an ability to a power of dissemination of knowledge to the students and to the professors. Sir, you have delivered the 7 days lectures. This is really an asset to the library of VIPM. All these lectures and all the interactions are with us as in our library and YouTube channel. And I hope that the participants or other than the participants, whosoever have any problem during the clinical examination and use of ECG, they can use this YouTube channel and to learn the art of ECG. So during your presentation, sir, you have made a complete and comprehensive coverage of all aspects of ECG. Sir, you have covered the diagnostic ECG, physiology of ECG, how to measure the ECG, arrhythmias, conduction disturbances. So I can say, sir, it is a and most of time, sir, in our VVS India's time, this topic is considered as a very dry topic. So during this presentation, because of art of presentation, you make this ECG, this topic, so simple, so informative to all our participants. So they have generated the interest in the use of ECG and interpretation of the ECG. So this is really a very excellent time with us for your remaining present and delivering a lecture, excellent lecture, very much liked lecture by you, sir. So during the presentation, I have been told that the almost 300 plus participants remain throughout the course. It shows your power of the dissemination of knowledge and teaching skills, so you can able to bind the students for this longer time on this topic. So really, on behalf of VIPM, on behalf of Alembic Pharmaceuticals, I express the sincere thanks to our learned speaker for accepting our invitation, for delivering the lectures for all complete 7 days, and satisfying the question of all participants in during this 7 days seminar. And the VIPM salute your personality, your knowledge on this occasion. I also thanks Professor Abdul Samad, a renowned academician and the legend of the veterinary medicine and the patron of our society. We always seek the assistance and the guidance from Dr. Abdul Samad, sir. We are extremely happy to see you on this platform. I'm also very happy that you are also present in 1 or 2 days during this e-course. And I really thankful for your presence and the comments especially you have given in the last year. Thank you very much, sir. And I also thanks all the participants who have connected throughout the 7 days for learning the art, and our learned speaker for remain present throughout the course. So they are very important assets, and they will use this knowledge and skill in their future diagnosis of the heart disease in the canine. I also thanks to our chief guest of day first, Professor G.K. Singh, the Vice Chancellor of Duwasu, for extending their help to Dr. Mukesh Srivastav for organizing this very important topic. And he also appreciated that topic you have selected is really excellent and useful to the students and the related stakeholders. I thanks to the Professor G.K. Singh, the Vice Chancellor of Duwasu, for all kind of assistance provided for organization of this e-course. I also thanks the Alembic Pharmaceuticals for providing, especially Dr. Santosh Shinde, Dr. Amit Singh, and Sri M. Karunanidhi ji for providing this digital platform, and also committed that we are already ready to serve this society through this way to all the professional societies. So really thankful to the Alembic Pharmaceuticals for providing this kind of positive approach and positive attitude to the science. I also thanks to the organizing secretary, Dr. Mukesh Srivastav, for designing and concept of this e-course, and you performed this course very excellently with the all co-organizing secretaries, Dr. Santosh Shinde and Dr. Neelay Sindhu, our media secretary, and Dr. Sudhir Mehta. I thanks and congratulate to all these organizing secretary for organizing such a very important and in such a nice manner for this 7 days e-course. This is my special thanks to the special guest. They were present during the e-course on a day or a very other day, and they have given a word of appreciation, a word of encouragement on the organization of this e-course. I special thanks to Professor again Abdul Samad ji and Dr. Rajesh Nikam, the Dean, Veterinary College, Mathura, Dr. A.S. Rawal from Anand, our Vice President, Dr. Atul Saxena, Director of Research of Duwasu, for remain present and their valuable comments during this e-course. I also have a special thanks to the VIPM President, Dr. Anil Dikane, and our Vice Presidents, Dr. Meena and Dr. Rawal, and our all general, two General Secretaries, and all members of VIPM for assisting and guiding to organizing such a e-course. I also thankful to everybody those helps to organize this e-course of 7 days on a very important topic of ECG. So in the last, the Veterinary Internal Preventive Medicine Society, it is committed and continuing to serve the veterinary profession by organizing the web seminars, e-course, and A-like events. So we are very encouraged with the words of our Dr. Abdul Samad sir. We have noted down, sir, your all suggestions. And surely we will incorporate some the clinical session in such type of the e-course. And we will continue to organize such important events to the service to the professionals. So this is really a matter of great joy and happiness to the society for the completion of a very excellent e-course of 7 days on ECG. And before the concluding or before the vote of thanks, I would like to again convey the message from Dr. Mukesh Srivastav that our next webinar that will be organized, and the topic of the next webinar is on the metabolic diseases of high economic impact on dairy farmers. is being delivered by our patron and great technician, Professor Abdul Samad. It is a very important topic. I think the all participants remain connected, and the flyer will go available very soon on the VIPM and other Facebook and YouTube channel for the detailed information. So once again, I thanks all of you for attending, participating, encouraging, helping to organize this e-course for 7 days. Now it's over to Mukesh Srivastava for the final completion.
Thank you, sir, for your blessing words. I am highly, highly thankful, and your words will definitely going to encourage in future planning of our webinars and e-courses. Sir, for the audience, for the participants, I have a message that VIPM Society is doing a webinar on each second and fourth Thursday of the month. Second and fourth Thursday. So the information will be available on the Facebook page of Society, that is Veterinary Internal and Preventive Medicine Society, or other means. So kindly join us and be a strength of our society. And with these words, thank you, Velankar sir. Thank you, Ashok sir. Thank you, Samas sir, and whole team of Alembic for this making easy this e-course for me. This is first experience of e-course. And previously, me and Ashok sir has organized a conference of VIPM at Mathura. After this, this is of the 7 days duration, and this is webinar. So, Dr. Shinde and team help most of the time. They help much more for this e-course, sir. So I am highly thankful for the Alembic team and our VIPM society, and especially Dr. Velankar sir. हमारे टीचर रहे हैं तो मैं तो हमेशा सर से जुड़ा रहा हूँ और जुड़ा रहूँगा सर और थैंक्स फॉर दिस ऑल दिस थिंग्स थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर नाउ द सेशन वी विल एंड द सेशन मुकेश सर सर कैन वी एंड द सेशन
हाँ यस डॉक्टर अमित नाउ द सेशन हैज फिनिश्ड सो कैंडली
Thank you very much, sir.